We're going to play our new song called In the Room. And
I just want to be in the room, want to be in the room when you move. And I'm not leaving.
Yeah.
I just wanna be in the room, wanna be in the room when you move. And I'm not leaving, I leave until you do. I just wanna be in the room, wanna be in the room when you move. And I'm not leaving, not leaving until you do.
Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in Him. Lord, we are here to see you move, and we've seen you move in this last year and a half. We've seen you move before that. We refuse to leave, though, until we see you move more and more. Until we see people of Irving, people of Route 16 getting healed, the people getting saved, the people recovering things that they've lost, people grieving come to an end. Lord, there is so much pain and strife in this world right now, and we sit here and we ask you, Lord, to bring that healing, to bring that joy that we seek, God. We're going to be here until you do, until you're done bringing it. Lord, I just pray thanks that we're so blessed to be here somewhere that's so consistent to be here to see you.
Just when Jacob was saying that, it just reminded me, and in the book of Joel, you have God's people, and it says armies of locusts. One comes and they devour all this area, and then another group comes and devours, and another thing comes and leaves the land desolate. And then God comes and he says that he will repay you for the years that the locusts have eaten. The great locust and the young locust and the other locusts and the locust swarm. My great army I will send among you. You will have plenty to eat until you are full. You will praise the name of the Lord your God who has worked these wonders for you. Never again will my people be ashamed. Then you will know that I am in Israel, that I am the Lord your God, and there is no other. Never will my people be shamed. But there's lots of things that have been stolen from us that need to be redeemed, that he promises to do right there. We're going to watch a video.
Do you see the video?
Yes.
Hold your ears.
Yes.
Okay.
What was that scripture?
Joel chapter 2 or 3.
You're a mean one. Mr. Grinch, you really are a hero.
I'm Mr. White Christmas. I'm Mr. Snow.
I'm Mr. Icicle.
I'm Mr. Ten Below. Fred.
Merry Christmas, Uncle.
Isn't there anyone who knows what Christmas is all about?
Sure, Charlie Brown. I can tell you what Christmas is all about. Lights, please. And there were in the same country shepherds, abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them. The glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. That's what Christmas is all about, Charlie Brown.
So, that's what Christmas is all about. So, and you know, there's a lot of times that things are going on and you don't really see it. You don't know what signs are pointing to and what they mean. And that's what I like to go through with Christmas, is the signs of Christmas and what they actually mean. This week, I'm just going to go through one song, and I'm only going to have two of you hand out, and one to everybody, and that song is the 12 Days of Christmas, and one thing you may not realize, can anybody tell me what year it is? What is it? 2022. So our years, whether they're accurate or not, are based on when Jesus was born. That's what our year. They used to always sign it, the year of our Lord, and then they'd write what year it was. So whether the whole world is privy to that, each time you say what year it is, you're saying how long it's been since Christ was born. So there are things that you see. How's that go? You see, but you do not perceive. You can see it, but you don't know what it's saying. So that's what this song is, the 12 Days of Christmas. And I did research on this years ago. But then I went through yesterday and was reminding myself, and I was looking to see what people were saying about it. So now the fact checkers have popped in, because it's the words out there that this song has secret meaning. So now the fact checkers have to come in and say, well, this is all wrong. So what they're saying is, how in the world, or why in the world, would people be celebrating Christmas and using this song to tell about their faith? And the reason is, in the 1500s, when this was done, it was okay for the church to teach something, but it was not okay for parents to teach something to their kids. So the fact checkers are going, why in the world would this happen? How could you celebrate Christmas? How could you have the freedom to celebrate Christmas, but not have the freedom to
to explain the truths of the gospel. It's because the church had a chokehold on people. They would only teach so much, and you cannot teach anyone unless you're clergy. So you think, oh, well, that's not a big deal. I'd teach my kids at home anyway. During this time, if the church found out that you taught your kids the Lord's Prayer in your own language, because they taught everything in Latin, if you taught your children the Lord's Prayer in your own language, you would be killed. That was the power that the Catholic Church had over people at that time. So they were free to celebrate Christmas. They're free to celebrate the birth of Christ. But they were not free to celebrate all the parts of what he means. They were not allowed to teach their own children the truths. So this song told those truths. So if anybody can sing it with me. On the first day of Christmas, my true love gave to me a partridge in a pear tree. On the second day of Christmas, my true love gave to me two turtle doves and a partridge in a pear tree. On the third day of Christmas, my true love gave to me three French hens and a three French hens, two turtle doves, and a partridge in a pear tree. See, this isn't as easy as it looks. On the fourth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me four calling birds, three French hens, two turtle doves, and a partridge in a pear tree. It gets really annoying. On the fifth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me five golden rings, four calling birds, three French hens, two turtle doves, and a partridge in a pear tree. Okay, we're going to stop right there. So, because if we get going, I'm going to start doing the Miss Piggy. And what she always did was five golden rings, ba-dum-bum-bum. So we can't do that anymore. I'm just going to tell you what each of those things mean. So, in secret, the parents were teaching their kids these truths about Christmas, the truths about their faith, a partridge in a pear tree. They were told the meaning of that is Jesus on the cross. In the Bible, it talks about, in the Old Testament, it doesn't say that Jesus will be put on a cross. It says that a person will be hung on a tree. So they're taking that idea and saying, okay, there's a partridge that's symbolizing Christ, and he's on a pear tree. So the second one, two turtle doves. They're teaching their children that we have a Bible. And that Bible is in two sections, the New Testament and the Old Testament. So you have two turtle doves. You have the Old Testament and you have the New Testament. Then we have three French hens. That is the three Christian virtues, faith, hope, and love. So if you read 1 Corinthians 13:13, that starts out with love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it is not rude, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, keeps no records of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. And then it goes on, and at the end it says that these three remain: faith, hope, and love. So when they heard three French hens, they're reminded of faith and hope and love. You can see people today, I believe somebody in my family has the shirt. Do you have one that says faith, family, and something, Tara? Don't you have a shirt that says that? They're all faith, family, and ducks. And so there's any number of versions of that. Four calling birds, or the original, it said four collie birds, and that meant blackbirds. And so those are the Gospels: Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. We've been trying to teach the kids the books of the Bible.
And that is how they would point out, okay, the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So they'd remember four calling birds, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Five golden rings, the five books of Moses, which is also called the Pentateuch, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. So when they heard five golden rings, they think five books of Moses, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. So, we'll sing again. On the sixth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me six geese a-laying, five golden rings, four calling birds, three French hens, two turtle doves, and a partridge in a pear tree. On the seventh day of Christmas, my true love gave to me seven swans a-swimming, six geese a-laying, five... What's five golden rings?
The five woods.
Which is what?
The five muscles. What?
What was that? Very good. Four calling birds, three French hens, two turtle doves, and a partridge in a pear tree. On the eighth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me... Hold on! Who's my true love? God. God gave me, God the Father gave me his son, the first one. God gave me the Old and New Testament. God gave me faith, hope, and love. God gave me the Gospels. God gave me six geese a-laying. Did we miss that one?
Ooh.
Oh, I haven't explained that yet. We're still on... On the eighth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me eight maids a-milking, seven swans a-swimming, six geese a-laying, five golden rings, four calling birds, three French hens, two turtle doves, and a partridge in a pear tree. On the ninth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me... Mine is messed up. Nine. Nine ladies dancing, eight maids a-milking, seven swans a-swimming, six geese a-laying, five golden rings, four calling birds. What's the four calling birds?
Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John.
Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Three French hens, two turtle doves, and a partridge in a pear tree. On the tenth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me 10 lords a-leaping, 9 ladies dancing, 8 maids a-milking, 7 swans a-swimming, 6 geese a-laying, 5 golden rings, 4 calling birds, 3 French hens, 2 turtle doves. What's 2 turtle doves?
You want an Old Testament?
Yeah, Anthony wants to get it right. If he had a bell, he'd be going like this.
Sorry.
So let's start at number 6. 6 geese a-laying. So, anybody got any guesses? You got it in front of you. The 6 days of creation. So we always want to remind our kids, how did we get here? And the world will tell them how they got here. They got here by a big bang. And amazingly, everything developed. I'm reminded of... I wish I had... Anybody have a soda with them? A soda can? Anybody have a soda can? A what?
I got a soda bottle.
I will take that.
Randy's getting thirsty. This is what's called the miracle of Mountain Dew. This is the miracle of Mountain Dew. Long, long ago, in this galaxy, there was nothing. And then, boom, there was a big explosion. And then there was the primordial ooze. There was all this stuff. And out of that stuff, creation started. There got to be rocks. And there was a rock. Why was the rock there? I don't know.
I don't know. But on top of that rock was a little drip. There was something green there. And then it began to grow. And on top of that rock, that green thing started to grow, and it became the shape of this bottle. And then the bottle began to get filled up with this green stuff. And then it began to have words on the side of the bottle. M-T-N
do. We know what that sign means. What's that sign mean?
Mountain Dew.
Mountain Dew. Well, then it started to get other words, and it had nutritional facts. And it said calories, 250. Total fat, zero. So you can drink as much of this as you want, and you will not be fat. Sodium, 85 milligrams. Total carbohydrates, 65. All this happened because a big bang happened. And it all got, all the soda got in there, and then a cap was applied. I don't know how, because no one was here to apply it. And there is the miracle of the Mountain Dew. How many of you believe that? I don't believe it either. You're way more complex than a soda. So how did you come from nothing? You, I don't know whether you swam or crawled out of that primordial ooze, and you just became, we just became human beings. That's as ludicrous as this soda appearing on a rock. It can't happen. It can't happen. How did it happen? One of you young ladies in the front, take this back to Sherry.
Someone studied everything.
Oh, talking about how did we get here? That is our six gisalei, the 6 days of creation. In the beginning, God said, "Let there be light." And then he made the sky, and he made the land, and he separated the waters and made the land. Then he put plants on that land. And then he made the sun and the moon and the stars. And some people go, oh, well, they made, the plants came, and each one of these days is 1,000 years. That's how we hook up with the craziness of a Big Bang Theory. Each one of these is 1,000 years. That's how it happened. Well, how did these plants grow for 1,000 years without day five, the sun, the moon, and the stars? That's silly. They didn't. God made the plants. The next day, he made the sun and the moon and the stars, and then those plants began to grow. And then on the sixth day, he made every kind of animal, and he made Adam and Eve. So that's the six geese a-laying in the song. Seven swans a-swimming. This is where I'm not sure exactly what they meant. It says seven gifts of the Holy Spirit, which isn't accurate, because when you look in Isaiah 11, it says wisdom, understanding, counsel, fortune, knowledge, and fear of the Lord. That's only six. So they throw in piety. So there's only six there. If you think New Testament and the seven gifts of the Holy Spirit, we have too many. We have wisdom, knowledge, faith, healing, miracles, prophecy, discernment, tongues, and interpretation of tongues. There's nine of them. So I'm not exactly sure which one of those they meant. So that's the seven swans of swimming. Eight maids milking is what we just went over in the Sermon on the Mount. Somebody want to read that for me really loud? Because mine messed up.
The Beatitudes.
Yes.
Matthew 5, chapter 5, 3, 12 through 3. Written down there.
3 through 12.
How blessed are those who are destitute in spirit, because the kingdom from heaven belongs to them. How blessed are those who mourn, because it is they who will be comforted. Blessed are those who are humble, because it is they who will inherit the earth. How blessed are those who are hungry and thirst for righteousness, because it is they who will be satisfied. How blessed are those who are merciful, because it is they who will receive mercy. How blessed are those who are pure in heart, because it is they who will see God. How blessed are those who make peace, because it is they who will be called God's children. How blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, because the kingdom from heaven belongs to them. How blessed are you whenever people insult you, persecute you, and say all sorts of evil things against you falsely, because of me. Rejoice and be extremely glad, because your reward in heaven is great. That's how they persecuted the prophets who came before you.
So those are the eight maids of milking. Those are the eight attitudes or beatitudes. The last one is separated into two things where it's talking about persecution, but that's all one of them. So nine is nine ladies dancing. How many of the kids remember the fruit of the Spirit? Both of you, start telling. So, when we get these things, when we begin to learn these things, and we put these things in us, it's when God is transforming us by a renewing of our mind. He's helping us to see things differently and grow spiritually. So, number 10 is the Ten Commandments. 10 Lords of Leaping. So, the Ten Commandments. I'm not going to ask you. I'm going to ask an adult that's not my child. Somebody start telling me what the Ten Commandments are. So you'll read them out loud.
No other gods. 2, no graven images. 3, don't use the Lord's name in vain. 4, remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. 5, honor your father and mother. 6, shall not kill. 7, shall not commit adultery. 8, shall not steal. 9, shall not lie. And 10, shall not covet.
So those are the Ten Commandments. Those are the 10 things that God points out to us you need to save you because you have broken these. And if you want to go to the Revelations, it tells us that all liars have their place in hell. So it's a pretty easy one to figure out. Have you ever lied? Yes, then you're a liar. So then you need a Savior. Have you lied more than once? Have you lied thousands and thousands of times? Yes. So I need a Savior. Have you ever dishonored your parents? In the olden days, we were just discussing this, they'd bring the teenagers who were rebellious to the city gates, and they would stone them to death. And so most of us in this room would probably not be alive today if they took that to heart. So if you've rebelled against your parents, you haven't honored your parents, you need a Savior. If you've ever killed anyone, does anybody remember what Jesus has to say about that?
If you look on someone with anger, then you practically killed them.
Right. If you hate someone, then it's the same as murder. And so is the same way with committing adultery. You go, well, I never committed adultery. If you look upon someone lustfully, you have committed adultery. The same thing, it says, all adulterers have their place in hell. So we need a Savior. So when they led their kids through these things, they were teaching them to fear the Lord, to trust the Lord, to get their strength from the Lord, to get in that relationship with Him. So, we're at 11. On the 11th day of Christmas, my true love gave to me 11 pipers piping, 10 lords a-leaping, 9 ladies dancing, 8 maids a-milking, 7 swans a-swimming, 6 geese a-laying, 5 golden rings, ba-dum-bum-bum. 4 calling birds, 3 French hens, 2 turtle doves, and a partridge in a pear tree. On the 12th day of Christmas, my true love gave to me 12 drummers drumming, 11 pipers piping, 10 lords a-leaping, 9 ladies dancing, 8 maids a-milking, 7 swans a-swimming, 6 geese a-laying, 5 golden rings, ba-dum-bum-bum. 4 calling birds, 3 French hens, 2 turtle doves, and a partridge in a pear tree. So the 11th day is the 11 apostles. We don't count Judas. Judas didn't stick around. So if you're ever wondering who those apostles were, and you look through the different places where they're listed in Matthew and in Mark and in Luke and in Acts, you're going to go, I count more than 11 or 12.
because some of them have different names in different places. Peter is also called Simon, but Peter is always number one on the list. He was, I'm guessing, the most important. Second, you got James. So there's more than one James. This is James, the brother of John, the son of Zebedee. Then you have John. Then you have Andrew and Philip and Bartholomew. And Bartholomew is also known as Nathanael. Number seven, Matthew. Matthew is also known as Levi, the tax collector. Thomas is also known as Doubting Thomas. Nine, another James, son of Alphaeus, or James the Less. Number 10, Thaddeus, also known as Judas, not Judas Iscariot, also known as Jude. And 11 was Simon the Zealot. So you have this problem. You've probably had this thing at work or at school, and you have two friends that are named the same name. And so then you have to change things. I know Tara has two girls at work with the same last name. So
same first name.
So they'll throw in an initial, or we at one time had two Kathys in the church. So we named one and one the other. And that's why this is done, is you've got more than one James. So we can't just call them James number one and James number two. One was, I don't know how he felt about this, but he was James the Less. But it wasn't because he was less important. It was because he was smaller than the other James. The other James was a big guy. So the same thing with Thaddeus. Thaddeus's name was Judas. After everything that Judas went through, would you want to be called Judas? No, you probably didn't want to. And so he also was called Jude. But he was not the Jude that wrote the book of Jude. That was a James, a brother of Jesus. So sometimes you get all these names floating around and they're really hard to remember. So that's the reason parents would teach their kids. It's like John. Which John are you talking about? Well, we always call one John the Baptist. And the other one is John, the one that Jesus loved. Did Jesus only love one John? No, he loved all of them. But it was a way to make that name distinct. So, 12. 12 drummers drumming. And this is the 12 articles of the 12 parts of the Apostles' Creed. And I'm going to read it to you, and you can read out loud along with me if you want, because this is the way a lot of churches do it. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. So that was the creed that taught people, what do we believe? Okay, I want to become a member of the church. What do you believe? Well, I believe in God. I believe in God the Father, and he's almighty. What else do you believe? He's the maker of heaven and earth. It wasn't a primordial ooze that made the Mountain Dew thing. It was somebody from Pepsi who made Mountain Dew. What else do you believe? I also believe in Jesus Christ. Well, what's so important about him? Well, he's God's only son, only begotten son, our Lord. What else about him? He was conceived by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary. Mary was a virgin when she had a child. Only woman in history, at least prior to artificial insemination. Suffered under Pontius Pilate. That gave a timeline. This
is when Jesus lived. There was a time in history that you can find this man named Pontius Pilate, and Jesus was alive then. He was crucified, he died, and was buried. And the third day after he was buried, he rose again from the dead. And you can find the truth in that looking through the Bible, that 500 people saw Jesus after he had raised. And we just talked about that a few weeks ago. I think that if you had a jury trial, you would have eyewitness testimony of 500 people. That would take 2 weeks to happen. Every person given their eyewitness testimony. If I saw this man who had died, everyone saw him dead, so they knew that was true. But now you have 500 people who saw him after he was killed by the Romans. So he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven. So bodily, he is no longer here in his human form. He sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. Do you know, this really surprised me when I left my first church and went to, came to Open Arms, and Pastor Matt was preaching. He pointed out where Jesus was right now. And Jesus is in the same place right now that he was for me 20 years ago. He is at the right hand of God the Father, and he's praying for us. That's what the Bible says. He's at the right hand of the Father praying. He's interceding for me, for you. He sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And from thence, or from there, he shall come to judge the quick. Does that mean people who run really fast? No, those who are alive. These are old words. The quick and the dead. So he's not only going to judge the people who are still living when he gets back. All the people who ever lived throughout eternity, their body, they will bodily be resurrected. If their bodies were thrown in the ocean, it says the ocean will give up their dead. And each of those people, no matter how long ago, they will bodily be brought up from the grave and be judged by Jesus. What else do you believe? As a Christian, what else do I believe? I believe in the Holy Spirit. This one is, you got three parts to God. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And this is the part of God that is the least understood, but is the most powerful in our day. And this is what we're going to be studying January, February, March, I don't know how long, is God the Holy Spirit. And I made a typo there. That should be a capital S. I make lots of typos. The Holy Christian Church, other versions say the Holy Catholic Church, but people get really upset when you say the Holy Catholic Church. But Catholic means universal. So I just, a lot of people throw that in so people don't go, oh, this is what happened when I first became pastor here. You're Catholic! You killed Jesus! Like, what? Well, you said the Holy Catholic Church. That means you're a part of the Roman church, and the Romans killed Jesus, so you killed Jesus. Well, we all killed Jesus. All of our sin killed Jesus. But that's why we put in the Christian church, because some people don't understand. The communion of the saints. The forgiveness of sins. That's what I believe in. I believe that our sins can and will, and if you believed, have been forgiven. The resurrection of the body, the life everlasting. Can anyone tell me what part, I'm just going to throw this in because it's free. Can anybody tell what part I threw out? Because it also makes questions. Yes, sir. What did I leave out?
You descended into hell.
Right. I leave that out, and lots of groups of churches leave that out because it gives the wrong idea. When you read that, descended into hell, what does that make you think?
So you went to hell.
It,
that he was in hell, that he was in fire and torment and all that. And so what preachers have gone in misunderstanding this said, oh, well, Jesus was handed into Satan's hand for 3 days and he was tortured and tormented and beat and ripped to pieces and all this. That is complete malarkey. That is made up by a pastor, a well-known pastor. That is not what happened. When you get to what language this was originally written in, Greek, it was the word Gehenna. And if you figure out there's two parts to, there's Gehenna and there's Hades. And so Gehenna is the place of the dead. Hades is where people are, where the dead are eventually punished. So that is the hell that we think of. Gehenna was, and this is sometimes hard for us to wrap our mind around, where did all the souls go when they died? It's called the bosom of Abraham. And so another name for it is Gehenna, the place of the dead. And so there was a waiting place until the Messiah came. And so Jesus, I believe this is in Corinthians, Jesus went from the cross to the grave, and while he was in the grave, his spirit went to Gehenna, and he led, set the prisoners free, and led them in, however it says it, he takes them out of Abraham's bosom, or the place of the dead, Gehenna, and leads them to heaven, because now the price has been paid for their sin. They were not allowed to be into heaven yet because the price had not been paid for their sin. So there was a place that God had them, and you can read about that in Luke, where you have Dives. What is it, Steve? What? Dives and the rich man. Lazarus and the rich man. So that's where you hear most of that story. So those are the 12 days of Christmas. They started doing this in the 1500s. It was first printed in a book in 1780. The melody that we just sang it in was not written until 1909 by Frederick Austin. And here's where I found some mistakes in the internet's thinking. In the end, how many partridges in a pear tree were there? One. The way some people look at this song, oh, well, on the 12th day of Christmas, he gave me 12 drummers drumming, which was new. But then he gave me 11 more pipers piping and 10 more lords leaping. They had this misunderstanding. So they said, oh, well, at the end you have 369 gifts. No, you don't. You have 78 gifts. And so that ranges, well, what they said was $40,000 to $100,000. Well, in the end, it's priceless. What did Jesus pay for your soul? He paid with his life, and that's priceless. So, do we have any questions? Because I know I went over that kind of quick. We have any questions of what something meant, what maybe information I left out? Thoughts, questions?
I have a controversial
topic. Okay. What?
About
yeah.
Wasn't that the place outside the Hebrew where they threw the trash in the dead bodies, right?
Right.
So couldn't that just represent also just that he was among the dead for 3 days? Because he was dead for 3 days.
Right.
So instead of
you say he was thrown in the trash for 3 days?
No, but he was a monk. That's what they referred to as a monk dead. So, I mean, like, we're going to the Abraham's bosom, but, like, there's no confirmation that's what it is. Does that make sense?
Other than the Bible.
Well, it doesn't. I'm just saying.
Gehenna.
Was such a strange term back then.
They called the junkyard.
Yeah, where they threw
Gehenna. Well, they, I don't know whether they threw many dead bodies there, but that's where they threw their trash.
Yeah,
and there was constantly a fire there. So that was where they got the idea of where they saw that. And they named it Gehenna because it was the same idea of hellfire, Hades. And so that's probably where people got confused in the first place, is that there's always a fire burning there, so that's like hell.
See, I've heard the opposite. In fact, Gehenna was, that's the reason they used the term Gehenna, because that already existed, and they thought it was the easiest way to compare to what hell would be. See what I mean?
Right. But hell is actually what we think of as Hades.
Yeah, would be their definition of Hades.
Right. So, any other thoughts, questions? Stones in your pocket. Yes, sir. No. That, you may have to repeat that, because maybe I heard you wrong. Did you say, was the devil a myth?
No, it's the devil in a fight with God.
In a fight with God?
Yeah.
He is under God's authority. We just read, me and a couple of guys read in the book of Job. God's there in heaven, and Satan comes into his presence, and he asks permission to do something to Job. So that shows that the only way Satan has the ability to mess with you or anyone else in here is Satan has to go through God to get the okay. And if God gives the okay, it's only because God knows that he will get you through whatever the problem is. So Satan really isn't at war with God, because that's kind of like me being at war with a fly, is I can just squish him in a second. And so Satan has tiny, tiny amount of power compared to God, because he only has what power God has given him. So he's not really
fighting against God.
Well, he's against him, but he doesn't, it's not a real fight.
He
doesn't
have. He lost at Calvary.
Right.
So his time is short. He's just doing whatever he can. He knows he's done. Man.
Right.
It's the whole, he'll stomp your head and you'll strike his heel. That's.
Right. So Satan is, the devil is against God, but in power wise, he really can't defeat him. He lost already when Jesus went to the cross. And Jesus paid the debt for our sin. So as Anthony was saying, he knows he's already lost. Now he's just trying to make as much trouble as he can while he can. So it's kind of, a lot of people say he's like a snake that is slithering around without his head. The way I like to look at it is he's just a chicken. And if you've ever seen a chicken with its head caught off, that's how Satan is. He's going this way, and then he's going that way, and then he's going every which direction.
Walks to and fro.
And so he's defeated already. So, any other?
Randy,
yes, sir.
Randy, he has
a follow-up.
I always had a problem with him like a bet.
I couldn't hear you. Oh, nope. Nope. Yes, sir. Right, yeah.
No, but he is walking about like a roaring lion, seeking to make power. And he is his main objective is to kill, steal, and destroy. So I do agree that he has to go before God, because he did that with Job. Because
right.
Job offered him. God offered.
Right. And so let's go back to that. Here's God's power up here. Here's Satan's power down here. We're like down here. So Satan is more powerful than us. But as long as we have God on our side,
Who can be against us?
Who can be against us? And so if that same story that happens in Job happens with us, God allows people to die every day. He does. And in truth, we have a wrong idea of death. When we die, we step into and become perfect. We get a glorified body. We get our perfect body. We get real life. We can see God in person. And so it says all of our crying is gone. Death is gone. The old way of life, of waking up in the morning with a pain here and a pain here and a pain there, all that's gone. So our view of death sometimes is messed up. We should be happy. When you come to this building, hopefully in 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, and you come to my funeral, don't be sad. I'll be happy. My family will be sad because I won't be around anymore. But I will be leaping and jumping and running and not growing tired. All the pain, all the not being able to breathe, all that's gone when I die. When you die in Christ, you are raised into perfection. And there's no reason to be sad other than you miss that person. You miss that person that you love. And that's a reason to grieve. But be happy for me when it's me, because it'll be the, I hate to say it to my wife and children, it'll be the best day of my life. They're the best now, but that will be the greatest day of my life, because it will be the first day that I'm truly, completely alive. Be completely alive. Sin will no longer have a hold. Death, where is thy sting? That's what happens when a Christian dies. So there's a reason to be sad because that person is gone. But that person, if they're in Christ, it's the greatest day of their life. So, we'll end with me blubbering like an idiot. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for being able to come in and worship you. And Lord, express our love to you. Lord, we just pray that you would, Lord, I pray that this paper that I handed out would be something that people would take home, and they would be changed by your words, by the Beatitudes, by the Creed, by the Ten Commandments, that the gifts that you offer through the Holy Spirit, the knowledge that we were created by you, not by accident, the places of your word the first five books of the Old Testament, the first four books of the New Testament, that, Lord, that this would draw people close to you and spur them on to know not just the song, but know the melody in your heart that is here, Lord, that life is here within these words. And so, Lord, I just pray that you would help them to keep it in their Bibles and use it again and again and memorize things and learn your word through it. And so, Lord, I just thank you for loving me and seeing me past who I was and who I still am sometimes, and loving me and drawing me closer to you. And Lord, I just pray that you'd continue to do that. And Lord, just be with us as we leave this place. Amen. Before we go,
I want to try not to be myself.
I want to try not to be. This isn't coming from a grouchy Randy place. This is coming from things need to be taken care of and done, and it's not one person's job or five people's job. It's everybody's job. So in January, I am taking January off. And when I say I'm taking January off, that means I won't be here at 8:30 in the morning to turn the heat on. So if you show up at 10:30 and you're the first one here, it will be cold. So someone needs to be here to do that. Someone needs to be here to turn on the lights. Someone needs here to be here to turn open the front door. Somebody needs to be here to do the coffee. Somebody needs to be here. We've had someone vacuuming and stuff, but there's a whole bunch of trash downstairs. And I keep looking at it and I'm going, every job isn't mine. My job is to teach and to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. So each job that I see around here is not my job, but I keep doing them. So if you have a way to get rid of all the trash, or if you just want to take it out to my trash cans, when it comes to January, I'm not going to do any of it. Zero. I'm taking the month off. I will be here, but the jobs won't be mine. So with that also, I'm going to have someone speaking musically. I don't know how that's going to happen other than if we have some videos played. That's one place, one way we could do it. But there's all kinds of things that go on around here that need to be taken care of that I will not be doing in January. So a lot of them I would like not to do all the time, because I truthfully I need more time to prepare with things like this. And same thing with music. That's more than enough. That takes a lot of time, and so I really need some people to step forward and ask, what can I do, or all that. And me and Tara, we can make a list of all the things, because I want her to take the month off too, because what always happens is then she's straddled with all the work that I do, and then she's more burnt out than she was before, and I don't want that. I want, the church is getting big enough to take on these jobs, and so I don't have a complete list, but I need some volunteers. I need someone to take care of this camera, to take those messages, whatever the messages are, if you have this ability, to take the little SD card and put it on the internet. I need all kinds of different things. So all God's people said, amen. Amen.